Hi, welcome to Work With Me. I'm the host, Amanda Lundy, and my two guests this afternoon are two very talented, very lovely women, actresses, Tiasha Ferme and Tara Linke, if I pronounce that correctly.
Perfect. That's pretty good.
Right?
Thank you.
That was like very my first good. Attempt at speaking German.
And French.
Yeah.
And Slovenian, all at once.
Look at
Perfect.
Me. So yeah, today we're going to be discussing what it's like to be in a one-woman show, kind of the obstacles that come along with that. And you know, if you guys want to talk about anything else, peanut butter toast, we're all game.
So. My favorite. Sure, we will.
Absolutely. All right, well, Tiasha, we'd like to start with you. Currently, you are doing a one-woman show at the Theater Lab in Chelsea, correct?
Yes,
slash Midtown. Do you want to tell us kind of what that's about?
Sure. It's called Wild Child in the City. It's a one-woman show. It's interactive and maybe a little bit immersive with some new technologies. But for the most part, it's just an absurd comedy about a woman living in New York and about all these impossible apartment situations that I did truly get into. Most stories are based on true events, or maybe all stories are based on true events. And it's actually opening this Friday. It's playing Friday through Sunday. And then Sunday, we have also a panel that Tara's coworker, Selvia Milo, will be a part of. And we're going to be discussing basically international and national touring of solo shows.
Very awesome. Mm-hmm. And these are women, like one-woman shows specifically, right?
I think that we do have one guy on our panel. His name is Erwin. And he's a theater director, but okay. I do think that he works a lot with solo performers.
Okay.
Yeah.
And I guess since we kind of talk about humanitarian things, did you find any hardships in kind of like coming to your one-woman show? Like, did you have to?
Absolutely. I mean, my one-woman show is based entirely out of mishaps. All the misfortunes that happened to me as a single woman in New York or as an actress in New York propelled making of the show. Because, okay, I'm gonna reveal a few little secrets, something that you would otherwise see only in the show, but let's start with the first story. Of course, we all live with roommates in New York, right? That's the only way to go, especially if you're in the arts.
Absolutely.
And then one time somebody broke into my apartment. He didn't steal anything, but he did pretend he was my boyfriend and hung out with my roommate. So he was a little bit of a sociopath. So, you know, like that's one of the stories that happened to me in New York.
That's terrifying.
And the other ones are just as creepy, crazy, like unimaginable, unless they actually happened to you.
Right.
When like a number of them piled up, then that's when I was like, okay, we have to write them down. This will be healing for everybody. And I really do think that it is, because everybody identifies with misfortunes of living and, you know, cohabiting situations in New York.
Absolutely. Well, and it's one of those things where you're like, oh, that kind of thing only happens on TV, and then it happens to you in real life, and you're like, oh no, like,
yes,
this
yes.
is actually gonna happen, okay.
Truth is stranger than fiction.
Couldn't agree with you more.
Yeah.
All right. Mm-hmm. Well, and Tara is also doing a one-woman show, which she's worked very hard for, called The Other Mozart. Do you want to tell us a little bit about what that is?
Of course, sure. I mean, it's actually not my show. It's a show of Selvia Milo, who also is based in New York. I am the co-producer in Europe. I arranged some tour in Europe for her. And Selvia is a producer and the writer and the main actress of that solo show, which is running since 3 years, very successfully, actually. And the great thing about this show is that it's about a woman. It's a biography about a woman who was living 250 years ago and who struggled and who was an artist, who was a musician, and who did not have the opportunity to really follow her calling because it was not proper for women. It's a show about the sister of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, who lived with her brother in Salzburg. She was 5 years older than he was, and she was a genius. She was a genius just as he was. And she got the same, she was playing with him, she was touring with him when they were childs. they were Wunderkinder, you know? It's like prodigy child. I'm sorry, I'm German, so my English might be just
a Wunderkinder. That's the only thing I take away from this
Wunderkinder. Wunderkinder. We are all Wunderkinder. So they were these Wunderkinders, and so is Sylvia, who picked up this kind of information which she didn't have before, that actually during her touring through Europe, she was visiting the Wohnhaus of Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart, where he lived at the time. And there was this picture of Wolfgang next to a woman who had an amazing hair. Like, as Sylvia says, she had an erection on her hair, on her head. So, and she was asking, you know, who is this girl, you know? It was kind of, there was this girl next to Wolfgang, and they, you know, they played Intervined. And she found out this man had a sister who was as genius as he was. And so she kind of figured out, you know, how to get some more information through the letters, because there's not much left over but the letters between the two of them and the father, Leopold Mozart. So, you know, after a while, it was just not proper for a woman anymore to, you know, she was not allowed to, for instance, take composition lessons. So then Leopold toured with little Wolfgang, continued the tour with him, and she had to stay at home and do some household chores and all that. So she was not really able to follow this. Right. And she, you know, she was 86, I think, when she died, or 83, I'm not sure, which is very old for that time.
Exactly,
very old.
Right? So because the life expectancy for back then was like, what, mid-60s?
Yes. Yeah. And it's like, you know, her brother lived until the age of 36. So Sylvia gathered all this information together, and she just had help, basically, from artist friends, and she gathered, like, this amazing crew, this amazing ensemble of, fashion designer for this wonderful dress, and composers also who, you know, underlined with a modern kind of contemporary classical music this play next to the music of Mozart, of course. And she was doing this, all living in New York in a similar situation as you do, right? And she was also like an actress in New York, not really, you know, she had work, yes, but right. It was never really satisfying her. And then she created that play, and that went off, and she has really good reviews, and I'm very happy for her.
It was kind of like the other Mozart, I'll avenge you.
Yeah.
I'll do everything I can.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah. Actually, I want to say something about that. I had the great privilege of seeing this play on Friday night.
Right.
And it was so beautiful and so moving. And I kept thinking, oh my God, I just want to go home. Like, stop right here. I have so much to think about. Because it really talks and, you know, about what it really means to be an artist, about what it means to be a female artist, or just about any artist. Every single person trying to be an artist has to face some kind of obstacles. Mm. And in this case, it's really incredible how her path was sort of like blocked because she was a woman, a very incredibly talented woman, yet a woman. Mm-hmm. And you know what the opportunities back at that time were, and what the roadblocks were that people needed to overcome. And then it's interesting because, you know, the big salvation of this family was like, oh, when, you know, Wolfie, as she calls him in the show, will become a court musician, and, you know, with the salary and everything, the family will be saved. You know, it also, even at that point, Mozart was for the most part considered a failure because he wasn't the court musician. Right. You know, and in that time, only for a short period of time, he was really on top and really admired and supported. But before that, he was also in debts. Mm-hmm. So there's like so many parallels between modern artists and, you know, artists from that era. And the funny thing is that as soon as he became, achieved the goal of becoming this court musician, he died.
Right.
Mm. And then, you know, then she continued, and she had her own life. And perhaps she did find some other fulfillment in other ways. So it's like, just like, you know, puts things on a scale of what is success. It's always relative.
Yeah. Exactly. And I think it's in general, it's not just a gender question or not only artists. It's
Definitely.
Like everybody who have this kind of calling or feel something that cannot be acted out somehow for some reason, for some rules, for some, you know, and this is like this kind of play really goes underneath the skin. You know, when I saw it for the first time, I mean, I saw people crying. I mean, at every show people cry, you know, because
like,
it's
I'm
just
almost
like
crying right now, so.
Because it's just so, you know, you just feel, you know, so many of us had this failures also, or the feeling of being a failure. And if you are just, you know, really believing in yourself and just, you know, going that path like Sylvia did, you know, I'm so proud of her. I'm a dear friend of hers. So she created her own show. And it's about artists, as you say, about an artist, about a human being that can, you know, follow her calling, but 250 years after.
Right. Yeah. Well, and it just, it makes you think about all sorts of different struggles. It sounds like it has a lot of depth. But I can only imagine, like, as any of us struggle to pursue our dreams, like, what it would be like where everyone's just like, no, you just can't. Not like, we get a lot of, like, you shouldn't or couldn't or, like, maybe you should do this instead. But instead, like, they get just, no. Like, that's not what you'll be doing.
Yeah.
So it fascinates me. But what an empowering show.
Yes. Yes.
Very great. And the show has been all over Europe, and so like Munich, Estonia, Vienna. It was in London,
Salzburg, London, Salzburg, Vienna are places where obviously the Wunderkinder were touring.
Right.
So this is very dear to Sylvia that she mapped it kind of that the Wunderkinder toured through Europe, and she wants to play in these locations, ideally in the locations where they've been, you know, to trace that.
I want to add that actually Wild Child was first performed in New York back in 2015 in April, and then it also went on two European tours.
Oh, awesome.
That were in Italy, Bulgaria, and Slovenia a few times, and then it got this audience award winner.
To a festival, right? The Fringe?
Yes, different festivals.
That's so cool.
In Rome, it was the Fringe. In Bulgaria, Sofia, it was, I don't know if you know, Sfumato Theater. Actually, Drama League just had a Bulgarian delegation, theater delegation, talking about their theater. And it's basically this ecstatic theater. And I was lucky enough to be invited to their festival last summer. And this summer, I went to their workshop to work with these, like, you know, two older people, Ivan and Margareta, two masters. Mm. And we're working on Beckett's Not I.
That's great.
So, yes, it was all festivals. And, yes, in Slovenia, it was also two festivals this year and last year. But it's international touring? such a secret. How do you really do it, right?
Yeah.
Because, like, it's partially, you know, applying to festivals and then knowing people that eventually know your work and then select you and invite you. Right. And it's a really interesting game. So I'm super curious how, when you say that you're a co-producer and that you're, like, producing and booking shows in Germany, how have you been working? What was your process?
Well, I just am like fond of this show. I saw this show and I was like, okay, my heart is beating right now. And I just called up. I just did some research and called the people and seduced them into it. That's basically it. You know, it's just like very simple. If you have a beating heart, people will believe you more. And then, you know, the show itself, I mean, if you have this kind of, may I just show this? This kind of dress and the picture is like already speaking for itself. I think it's not easy. You have to convince people, especially in Europe, things work differently.
Everybody plans for a year in advance.
They plan, exactly. We had the same
situation. All the
money
comes from the state, so you have to plan way in advance.
Right, exactly. Plus in Europe, they're not so much used to, like here in America, like that you are an actor, but you're a co-producer and you do maybe other jobs on the side.
It's
just
right.
Like, they have just one single thing, and
one
they
vision.
Have a task, one vision, and that's it, you know? And then they have to, you know, get used to this
right.
kind of conversation.
There's like no independent theater, so to speak.
Yeah.
Right?
Exactly.
It's always like, you know, like big organizations or state-funded theaters.
So everybody's getting paid, huh?
Yes. For the most part. That's the best part of Europe.
That's not a bad thing.
That's awesome. Very so cool. Are you a part of festivals, or are you independently produced by these theaters?
No, I'm totally independent. I do this for Sylvia. I'm not a producer usually. I have, you know, I produce my own things, my own shows, but I helped Sylvia in this because it's just, you know, fabulous, and it needs to be shown, like, in Salzburg and Vienna. I mean,
for sure.
this is, you know, everybody talks about Wolfgang there. You have the Mozart balls, as they
say. It's this kind of chocolate. I bought one of those when I was there. It's just a ball of chocolate with Mozart's face on the foil.
Right, exactly.
Mozart's depends inside.
And we're working on a nano ball as well, because she had balls. yes.
So how many, sorry to interrupt, I'm so curious.
Me too.
What are all the names of this character? Nana, Marianne?
Marie-Anna Mozart.
Maria
Anna Mozart is her real name. And Wolfie called her Nano. I mean, that's kind of the sweet.
Yes, because for the most part she's called Nana, but then sometimes it's Marianne, and I'm like, Mariana.
Okay. Any experience that I have with a younger brother, he's always gonna mess up your name. Like, from the age of 0 to 5, he's gonna call you any kind of like garble that comes out of his mouth.
What did yours call you?
Nana. It's Amanda.
Thing. Oh my God.
I would totally yell at him. Like, I'd be like, it's Amanda.
Like, what's his name?
Ryan.
Not Wolfie.
Not Wolfie. I'm gonna start calling him that, though. He's not gonna get
First, you come see the show.
Yeah, exactly.
So I wonder, because I've never produced really my own show, like with an idea, which just, you know, where I had this glimpse of something. I wanted to know what was that moment where the sparkle appeared that you do your own thing, or was it like triggered by something outside, or?
Okay, I'll explain.
Was it growing slowly? What was it?
I did another show before that. It was called Cocktails, Confessions of a Infomaniac. And it's actually a six-person show. And this was produced in, we had like 5 different workshop productions. It was going on for years. And then finally it found its form. And then after I produced it, it was produced and picked up by different theaters and went on tour. And for this particular one, it felt like the pain of these bizarre experiences, which I didn't know how to deal with them emotionally. And I also felt so, you know, violated. Somebody breaks into your apartment. And like I said, this is not a sole example. You know?
Right. Mm-hmm.
So like this kept happening to me, and I was like, what is it, the universe, that you're trying to tell me? What am I doing wrong? You know, what's happening here? So after, you know, talking to people, talking to friends, I don't know, I just realized that there's so many of them and that they're so redeeming for me to say. And that there is something so absolutely universal about this struggle. Mm-hmm. Everybody identified, and everybody had yet another story of like something that happened to them or to their cousin. So it was just like, I wrote the entire thing in about 2 weeks. I just needed to do it. That was like the biggest urge I've ever felt, I think.
Wow.
And then once it was done, written on the paper, I just knew it, that I needed to put it out there. I actually wrote a play 7 years before that's been sitting on my desk or in my drawer, and I haven't been able to do anything with it. And I really thought that this was the time to produce that play. Sorry for spitting. But it wasn't, because this play really wanted to find its way out. And so I think first I was invited to one space, then it didn't work out, and then I was feverishly looking for another one. And Secret Theater said, oh, you know, actually, we've been just thinking about creating a solo performance festival. Why, maybe we can include you, maybe you could be the highlight and, you know, perform on 4 days, and, you know, then we have other smaller productions that come in and out and show their
work.
That's
wonderful.
And so that's exactly what happened.
Wonderful.
That's exactly what happened. What was really weird was that I also got extremely sick. That was like the beginning of winter of 2015. Everybody got that flu.
Yeah.
And so I was almost like bedridden, and all I couldn't do anything but really focus on the show. So it was a blessing in disguise.
Right?
You know, like also in your show, I feel like it shows so many times how obstacles are what actually shaped their talent.
Yeah.
You know, certain things that were forbidden to her, that's why she started doing this other thing. And which really made her original and special. So I think that this weird coincidence of being sick and not being able to do anything else. Otherwise, I'm like very bubbly and dynamic and I run around and, you know, I dissipate my energy. But this, you know, it was a month and a half of when I was just in the middle of the winter at home. And, you know, yes, I, in order not to go nuts, even though I was going nuts, I did the show. You know, wonderful. I produced it and all of that. Yeah. I also fundraised. I think this was the first. No, it wasn't the first time I did Indiegogo. I did Indiegogo actually to fundraise to go to Europe, because once I was in Europe for the first tour, everything was provided for, but the transportation costs were quite high. So I fundraised for that. But long answer.
That's wonderful. Actually, what I wanted to comment on though is like that, especially in a like comedic role too, it's when you find all of those people that completely understand, like they either empathize with you, they have similar stories, and they, you know, they can see, yes, that's relatable, and they're and therefore funny. And I think that's one of like the best, most rewarding things about doing this is seeing, you know, the joy that like the pain brings. Does that, I was like, oh, that maybe sounds kind of weird, but like you go through all of these things, and but the joy that's brought out of it is just,
I know,
so much more and so much more rewarding. So
the more the merrier. It really goes like that.
Right, yeah. Exactly. But great. Well, I mean, did you have any, I don't have any other questions for you guys, except for like, when are we going to hang out?
Yes. Well, I mean, let's all hang out. I guess I have to do this. Please come see my show, everybody.
Right?
Yes. September 30th, October 1st at 8, and October 2nd at 5, followed by a panel on
Tell Solo Us Where.
Theater Lab. 357 36th Street, West 36th Street between 8th and 9th. Please come, everybody. And we'll hang there, and it'll be fun. Sure.
Perfect.
Yeah. I'll definitely be there.
Yeah.
All right.
And we also have the show going. I have to read it because I just arrived yesterday from Germany, so I'm still not out of my jet lag.
Fall asleep.
So the show is running in the Players Theater in McDougal Street. So it's 115 McDougal Street, third floor. September 23rd, so we started this weekend. It's running every weekend until November 13th, Friday and Saturday. So, and it's always at 6. Sorry?
Seven.
No.
7.
At 7, sorry. Seven. And in January also we have the show running. So it's going to be Sylvia and some understudies of her, because she trained, and that's a great thing about Sylvia, is she's sharing this part with other girls, with other women, especially women. And the great thing is that women from 14 to, you know, 86 can perform this, because it doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, she was, you know, it's not a story, you know. So she trained all these girls to be, or women to be part of this, to, and she, her dream is to have an army of nannies all around the world. And doing this show and speaking up for this woman and for all the women, especially also women composers, all women artists that we don't know about.
Right.
You know, oh, like Virginia Woolf's Shakespeare's sister. You know, it's just like there were so many. I mean, how many women composers do we know? None.
Yeah.
Right? None.
Yeah, exactly.
And she apparently composed. This woman actually composed, and Wolfie wrote in one letter, he was amazed, and it was just stunningly beautiful. These were his words.
And
nothing is
now?
Left. Nothing is left.
Yeah.
Nothing. We don't know anything about her music. So that is still like this big question mark, which is in the air, which also, you know, if you leave the theater, it's just like, we lost another Mozart.
Right.
We have lost another Mozart.
Well, and like, what an array of feelings to leave after seeing something like that. Like, it sounds like uplifting and empowering, but also like sad and...
Oh, it's a lot of humor. It's
Okay.
Yeah, because I mean, Wolfgang and Nannerl were just all about, you know, like farting and, you know, making these funny
right.
jokes. I mean, it was at the time, it was like, oh, your feet smell. Yeah, just put your feet out of my face, because at the time they were laying, you know, the beds, they had to share the beds, and
right.
so, you know, so they were laying, one was like that, the other one was the other way around. So it was all sorts of, you know, it was not like nowadays where everything is just
so clean.
We don't talk
so
about these things, you know, it was like You know, it's a lot of fun. The show is really, really great. Told with a lot of lightness. I mean, and yours too.
Definitely
recommend it. I haven't seen the show because I just arrived here, but
she's coming.
I'm coming for sure. And I saw the little video on your website. What's your website's name?
It's my name, tiashaferme.com/wildchild.
Wild child.
Yeah.
Yeah. So
we also have a YouTube channel, and you know, there's some filtering through Theater Lab's website.
And the video is really fun. It's really fun to watch.
Yeah,
so I really am curious about that play, and I really want to hang out with you girls.
Oh, yeah.
It's wonderful.
It's going to be great.
Yeah. Thank you.
But like, isn't it kind of sad when you're like, oh, like so many women go through life and they don't do anything that they were ever passionate about. They don't do anything that they have like ever really took a stand for anything. And I'm like, I won't
be that woman.
I won't end up that way. Like,
yeah.
I mean,
it's so amazing to like for women to come back to you and tell you how your work has impacted them. It's like one of the best feelings ever. I'm sure that Sylvia feels this way when you talk to her because you're so passionate about this project. But like I have had people that come to me that were like, your project has healed me. I have a woman now that has this like whole, she opened up her own space and she's finally like doing what she really wants. And she's an affluent woman. She can afford it. And she also wants to create a platform for women to come together.
Oh, wow.
And I said to her, I read this on my friend's Facebook. And she says, if you want to go alone, you can go far. If you want to go together, you can go deep.
Whoa.
And she was, it's really like women have to stick together and work together, you know?
Well, and I think in
why is the time up?
Yeah, now
that was a good one.
Oh, man. And I think it's interesting too because we're in this like generation, like this moment in time where like a lot of women are making other women their enemies. And I'm like, no. Wrong enemy.
You know what? I really love this point in your play. Where basically they keep waiting for Wolfgang. They keep waiting for a Wolfgang to save them. And then otherwise she'll have to get married.
Right.
And then at some point they give up and she gets married and the father dies. And then